So memory. Can an entire population have a common memory? Well, yes, it can. And it operates quite like our individual ones. This matrix of cultural memory helps. It doesn't tell us rights or wrongs, just how cultural memory works. It has four quadrants based on remembering and forgetting, and active and passive. Starting in the bottom right, or passive forgetting, we have articles there that were lost long ago, like a broken pot or a tablet. And these items are not thought about again shortly after they disappear. Bottom left is passive remembering. Again, an old article, but this time rediscovered, like that vase that sits in a museum. We look at it passively. It's there, it's interesting, but it doesn't alter our worldview. Top right, we have actively forgotten. This is more interesting. These are memories that were deliberately lost. Activity went into their forgetting. Stalin in the Soviet Union was very good at this. His regime would deliberately remove photographic evidence of people he didn't like or who were purged. Religions also practiced it, burning the books of heretics to actively remove their memories. Christians tried eradicating the Gospel of Thomas this way, and prior to 1000 AD, it looked like they had succeeded. In top left, we have active remembering. Holy texts sit in this quadrant. They are endlessly studied as believers try to make sense of the world they live in by referring back to these books. Different meanings are extracted over the centuries as adherents actively find fresh interpretations. So when they discovered a centuries-old Gospel of Thomas in 1945, that was interesting. That moved the book out of actively forgotten to actively remembered. And now students pore over it, experts study it, making new meanings from it. Now, it doesn't take much imagination to realize that long ago, religious students of the scriptures actively extracted reasons for holy war or justifying war from their texts, and particularly when their own nations were under attack. As recently as World War I, all good Christian men were expected to fight in that conflict, and many were jailed for refusing to do so. Similarly, it doesn't require much thought to realize that many Muslim students today extract admonitions about peace from their holy texts. Sometimes this means actively forgetting injunctions to fight. Conversely, other Muslims believe Islam is under attack today, and they actively remember passages from the Quran on how to retaliate. Now, before you throw this matrix out the window, consider that we're all subject to it. This operates in our personal memory too. You've forgotten things carelessly. You also refashion memories. That classmate who hurt your feelings decades ago becomes a long-lost friend when you meet him at a school reunion. You might have painful memories that you want to forget, that you don't like being recalled. You might even yell at someone for reminding you, like your wife. So it's understandable when an entire culture or religion doesn't want to be reminded of painful or embarrassing events long ago. No wonder it took a pope 500 years to apologize for overrunning South America in the 16th century. However, every 2 years, we double the amount of memory the world ever had. Our challenge now is no longer remembering with all that big data collected. We are learning new rules of how to forget. Now, this is a game religions have experience in. They once monopolized memory. They once told followers what to remember, what to forget, and what to change. And they're still very good at it.